Hi, I'm Dr. Steve Pod from the RD&E Hospital, and today I'm going to be talking about cardiac syncope, and in particular, bradyarrhythmia. The aims of this tutorial are to be able to identify the 3 degrees of heart block and be aware of the danger signs that something needs quick or immediate treatment. To start off with, we should look at the normal conducting system of the heart. In the atrium, we have the sinus atrial node, which has a rate of between 60 to 100 beats per minute. And this will transmit this message to the AV node, which will keep hold of this for 120 to 200 milliseconds, which is 3 to 5 small squares on the ECG. And this will then conduct along the specialist conducting tissue that splits into the left and right bundles. When we see bradycardia, this could be from sinus node disease. This is generally benign and has a number of reversible causes, particularly drugs, vagal influences, which are very common in young people, and also acute ischemia. The right coronary artery gives a branch to the sinus node, and so in inferior myocardial infarction, this should always be looked for. This may require treatment if patients are symptomatic, but it rarely needs to be treated urgently. Another example of sinus node disease will be somebody with chronotropic incompetence, i.e. their heart rate doesn't go up with exercise. And again, this may respond well symptomatically to pacing, but does not require emergency treatment. When we come to the AV node, we split this up into the 3 degrees of heart block. First degree heart block, where the PR interval lengthens, or second degree heart block, where you have Wenke back, is seen as low grade AV nodal disease. And very much like sinus node disease, is often benign and really only requires treatment if symptomatic. Again, there can be reversible causes. And in the example of inferior myocardial infarction, there is a branch to the AV node from the right coronary artery. So again, in inferior MI, this should always be looked for. Lastly, we have high degree AV nodal block, which is general second degree heart block, Mobitz 2, where there'll be 2 P waves for every QRS, or complete heart block, which is where there is no connection between the atria and the ventricle. Both of these examples are potentially life-threatening and often require urgent or immediate treatment. I have also mentioned in that box trifascicular block, and I will show an example of this within the ECGs and explain why that can potentially be dangerous if the patient is symptomatic. This ECG shows sinus bradycardia, and we know this because the RR interval is over 5 big squares. It shows a normal PR interval, that is a PR interval that is between 3 and 5 small squares. It shows a normal axis and a normal QRS width, that is a QRS width of less than 3 small squares. This is all covered in our basic ECG tutorial. Sinus bradycardia does not require treatment unless a patient is symptomatic. This ECG shows again a narrow QRS complex with a normal axis, and the heart rate is just above 60 beats per minute. When we look more closely, the PR interval is over 2 big squares, and therefore over 400 milliseconds. Because there is 1 P wave for every QRS, i.e. every stimulus from the atria gets through to the ventricle, this is first degree heart block. As we have said before, this only requires treatment if the patient is symptomatic. This ECG is slightly more complicated. If we look closely at the rhythm strip, we can identify the P waves and the QRSs. The first thing to notice is that the interval between the P waves is the same, i.e. the rate in the atria is steady. This can be extremely useful when looking at difficult ECGs, as some P waves can be hidden within T waves and QRSs. By identifying two clear P waves, you should be able to move backwards and forwards to identify all of your atrial activity. And in turn, this can allow you to relate it to what is going on in the ventricle. And this should allow you to be able to diagnose the degree of heart block. Hopefully on this ECG, you can see that the PR interval is increasing with every beat until we get to this P wave, which is not conducted to the ventricle. Following this, we have a short PR interval again, showing that this is going in a cycle. And this is a good example of Wenke back. Again, unless the patient is symptomatic, this is often benign. This ECG also shows Wenke back, and we'll look at this more closely. However, the difference between this ECG and the last one is that the QRS duration is long. And when we look at V1, there is an M shape showing right bundle branch block. What is also interesting is that the PR interval on the conducted beat is long. The P wave rate is regular as in the previous ECG. So we can identify all of our P waves. There's one embedded within the T wave. And there is the dropped P wave without a QRS following it. Again, this is Wenke back, but in this example, there is also right bundle branch block, which may indicate a higher degree of AV nodal block. And therefore, this may be more dangerous than our previous ECG. Looking at this ECG, again, it is narrow complex QRS with a normal axis and is quite bradycardic. When we look at the relationship between the P waves and the QRS, there are two P waves for every QRS. This is therefore 2-to-1 heart block, which is second degree heart block. This will be classified as a high degree of AV nodal block and should require urgent treatment. Finally, this is a very important ECG to be able to recognize. Hopefully you can immediately tell that it's bradycardic as the RR interval is over 5 big squares. We naturally have a mind that will look for patterns. And often when I present this ECG, people look at the PR interval and assume that there is a PR interval that is elongating when we look from left to right. And then there is a dropped P wave. However, as I've mentioned earlier, you should look carefully for two clear P waves. And after the fourth ventricular beat, two clear P waves can be seen. When you work backwards and forwards, these P waves then show themselves embedded within QRSs and within T waves. With the P waves identified, it's fairly clear that the P waves are dissociated from the QRS complexes. This is therefore complete heart block and should require immediate treatment. Let's look at it more closely. Here we have a broad QRS showing an escape rhythm from the ventricle. as I said, more than five big squares between the QRSs. And then finally, identifying all the P waves, you can see that the atrial activity is regular and all the embedded P waves are obvious. This last ECG is going to show us trifascicular block. When we look at the QRS, it is broad and there is an M shape in V1 representing right bundle branch block. The PR interval is long at almost 400 milliseconds, but there is one-to-one conduction between the atria and the ventricle, i.e. there's no dropped conduction, and therefore this would be first degree heart block. And lead one is positive, AVF is negative, and lead two is negative, showing the axis to be leftward. We therefore have first degree heart block, right bundle branch block, and left axis deviation. This we would call trifascicular block. Even though it's called trifascicular block, it's not three separate conduction abnormalities. What it really represents is relatively advanced disease of the AV node. Therefore, a patient with trifascicular block that presents with symptoms should be offered pacing, as there is potential to develop higher degrees of block, either intermittently or permanently, that could put the patient at risk. So to recap, right bundle branch block, first degree heart block, and left axis deviation. Now, these are the take-home messages. I think when you look at an ECG, always find two clear P waves and then work backwards and forwards to find all of the embedded or hidden P waves that may be within the QRSs or T waves. Usually the best leads to look at are lead V1 or lead 2, as the P waves are more prominent. Once you have identified the P waves, it's very easy to identify the QRSs, and therefore, working out the pattern between them, you should be able to identify the degree of block. Finally, once you've done that, you should be aware of whether that type of block is potentially dangerous and whether they require urgent or immediate treatment. Hopefully, this has given you some good examples and a good understanding of the different degrees of heart block, and I'd invite you to look at our next video, which is a quiz on bradyarrhythmia, and in particular, working out whether things are dangerous or safe. Thank you very much.